On today's show,
the Lakers are upset with D'Angelo Russell, and Russell Westbrook's upset with Reggie Jackson. But is any of this news?
In Crossfire, which franchise is cursed? And are you pro or con Coach LeBron?
And the Kings have signed Vlade to a multi-year contract extension, but does he deserve it?
It's Wednesday, March 30th. The Starter starts now.
Good evening, Sweet World, and welcome to The Starters. Whether you're listening to the podcast or joining us live on NBA TV or a little bit later on YouTube, we're happy to have you. I'm J.E. Skeets, and alongside me, as always, that's Tass Millis.
We will witness a wedgie on this wonderful Wednesday.
Oh, all right.
That's from MC Pavlik on Twitter. I couldn't write that.
Two is right. International man of mystery taking it to the max. That's Lee Ellis.
Friend. Lele.
Lele. And last, certainly not least, over there, that's Starters blog editor, Trey Kirby.
Heyo!
Heyo!
TK, what do you got for us tonight?
Well, I'm here at the internet looking for your best tweets at hashtag TheStarters, and our good buddy Zach Lowe dropped another Fire Tuesday column over at ESPN yesterday. Checking in at number two on his likes and dislikes this week, unorthodox closeout strategies. Now, if you don't know what Zach's talking about, it's things like this. Gerald Henderson jabbing his head at Matt Barnes while he tries to take a three up top. Yeah, very interesting move. Or maybe Thad Young stopping his check-in just so he can yell at Kyrie Irving's three-pointer from the sideline. Hey, miss it. Apparently it worked. Basically, anything that is not just putting your hand up in the air, that's an unorthodox closeout strategy. So it brings us to today's question. What's your go-to three-point distraction move? If you listen to our long-form podcast, The Drop, you already know mine. It's called pulling out the brownies. Brownies! Brownies!
Oh, the double brownies.
He loves it.
Brownies! I learned that from my buddy Josh Franks back in freshman year of college, and it's worked every time since. Try it at the gym sometime. But we want to hear from you. Send us your go-to distraction moves at hashtag TheStarters, and we'll hear from you a little bit later.
Okay. Brownies.
I'm still traumatized from
yeah,
that.
Yeah, you missed all those shots.
Of course
there
I did.
A couple air balls there.
Brownies on those dinner plates.
All right. So, on tonight's show, it's Wednesday, so Tass and I will go head-to-head in a heated round of Crossfire, and we'll open up the Starters mailbox again, answer a few of your questions. You guys are great at sending those in. But we start with a little bit of Is This News. Today's the perfect day for Is This News. Trey rounded up some recent NBA headlines. He pitches them to us and to you watching, of course, and we determine whether or not they're actually news. Trey, what's the first headline?
Yeah, our first headline comes to us from the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel, and it reads, Jason Kidd says Giannis Antetokounmpo will run point next season for the Bucks. Is this news?
I think this is a little bit of news, because this is a no-win situation for Jason Kidd, and this is another quick-trigger decision that he's been prone to do after his post-playing career. 1 year in Brooklyn, I should say, is going to call it New Jersey, he decided to move on because he didn't have enough control to make moves like this, trading Brandon Knight, who was having an all-star type season, away for Michael Carter-Williams. Michael Carter-Williams only started 62 total games, but he's already decided, nah, Giannis Antetokounmpo is our starter. He also got Greg Monroe this offseason, and then he tried to get Dwight Howard at the trade deadline, a move which I actually agreed with. But this Giannis Antetokounmpo move, I don't see any benefit to make this sudden decision.
What is the point?
What is the point of him calling it out right now? Is it to give Giannis confidence? You don't need to give Giannis confidence. This man has come from selling trinkets on the streets of Greece to being a fantastic basketball player in three short years. There's no reason for that. And I think Jason Kidd's actually going to be looking for a point guard this offseason because he definitely has a say in decisions. He still will be looking for a point guard to help out Giannis. And then what happens? Well, Giannis, yeah, you know, you're not going to handle the ball as much. I just don't see a reason. Just let Giannis concentrate on shooting the basketball this offseason, getting a better shot, and not having to worry about running the point and playing guard or defense against the best position in basketball. There's just no reason to do it. So I do think this is a bit of news to throw this into Giannis' lap for no reason.
And it lowers any trade value that Michael Carter-Williams might have going into the summer.
Yeah, that's true.
Because he's basically made him redundant. But I also agree, I don't see why a team that's not going to make the playoffs would make an announcement like that now, because in the summer, you just don't know who might be available, what salary cap space you might have, and which player might come your way. So I think it's, I just don't see any value of what you gain out of doing it right now. But if he's given the right coaching and he's given the right pieces around him, I don't see why it can't work for Yanni and for the Bucks.
I mean, he's been unbelievable in the month of March
as
the point guard, forward, center, whatever you want to call him, like Jason Kidd said. I mean,
exactly.
Is he a really point guard or is he just a basketball player that can do a bit of everything, whatever you want to call him? I think the only thing, I mean, I agree with you guys, it's a tad bit of news, it's only news, a little bit of news, because he's been doing it and playing the position, but for a kid to lock it in is interesting. It's almost like, why didn't he just go to Yanni himself and say, look, you're going to be my point guard for the future. I want you to work on X and X and X during the summer. I want you to get obviously comfortable with the playbook and running plays and just being more of a distributor and not saying it publicly. But, you know, if he believes, he looks at his roster and maybe he's even thinks that we're not going to really get any sort of point guard talent in an offseason move, then why not hand the keys to him and say, hey, look, it's your car. You run this bad boy.
Again, I just think, though, you just don't know what's going to happen this summer with so much salary cap space. There's going to be a lot of moving parts. You just don't know who might be available via trade or free agency or whatever. So I just don't think it makes a lot of sense to lock in one position for next season already.
Look, it's interesting to watch from our perspective. Hey, a 6'11" and a half inch point guard.
He's great to watch.
He's great to watch, but I still think they want another ball handler. And I think that's what Jason Kidd was saving himself by saying, call him what you want, point guard, point forward, point center.
Yeah, we'll see. All right, next headline here, Trey.
Our next headline comes to us from ESPN, but it could have come from Us Weekly, In Touch, or OK Magazine, and it reads, Lakers teammates are isolating D'Angelo Russell after Nick Young video surfaces. Is this news?
Of course it's news. It has been dominating the news cycle for the last at least 24 hours, really since the weekend in some circles, and only now today because of the ESPN story from Baxter Holmes and Mark Stein and Ramona Shelburne chipping in there has really become sort of the sports news item of the day. It's news. It's very weird. I don't think it's going to last all that long. Tonight we've heard that both D'Angelo Russell and Nick Young are going to talk to the media, and I would expect D'Angelo Russell is going to say, I screwed up. I apologize, my bad, let's try and move on. Because he did. Whether or not it was a mistake, we still don't really know how the video got out there to everyone, but it was a mistake nonetheless. You've seen the video, I'm sure, by now. And Swaggy P doesn't know he's being recorded. Even at the end of the clip, he says, thanks for saying this to my camera. And Swaggy P's like, what? What do you mean? What? Why are you recording this? Was that just a dumb prank, as people are saying, because they've been going back and forth all year? Or was it some sort of situation where D'Angelo's upset with Swaggy and is almost like targeting him. That's a whole other story. But look, I would be upset. If you're a Lakers player, you would be upset. You'd be upset with a dumb mistake from a 20-year-old kid because it does violate your trust. There's no doubt.
It's broken the unwritten man code that happens in locker rooms in every single sport. Sure. But to me, it's not news. It's news for media takeout. It's news for TMZ. But I don't think this changes the Lakers' locker room at all going forward. What, are they going to lose more games? I mean, they're a terrible basketball team. And I don't think this prohibits or kind of pushes other guys not to go sign with the Lakers because a 19-year-old made a mistake.
Again,
it's a mistake, and that's it.
I think this story, honestly, is gone in 24 to 48 hours. And if it's not, it'll be gone by the end of the season because the Lakers, they're not going to the playoffs, so we're not going to see them.
It is still a pretty sensitive topic within that team.
Sure.
And if I was the Lakers, we know they're not going to the playoffs, I would maybe consider just keeping D'Angelo away from the locker room for a couple of days just so they can clear the air a little bit, because we saw against the Utah Jazz, they were awful. I know Byron Scott denied that they had anything to do with their on-court product, but I actually think these sorts of things do affect chemistry within the locker room.
I think but I disagree with you, Lee. I think that's the worst thing to do. I think he needs, again, he, and I expect him to do this tonight, he's going to come out, and he should apologize to Nick Young, to Iggy Azalea, to Lakers organization. He should own it and say, I screwed up.
Yeah, but Iggy Azalea tweeted, she tweeted right at D'Angelo Russell. She said, hey, you're trending, and that was a great video. I actually liked this
Hashtag
film.
Hashtag sarcasm?
Thanks, bro. I don't know. She likes it.
Yeah, well, either way, though, the Lakers
opened her eyes, guys.
It's just another
That's why this isn't going away. She's famous, too. Yeah. We're going to keep hearing about this.
And it's just another black eye for the Lakers organization. It's an embarrassing moment when they're supposed to be recognizing one of their greatest players of all time, and now people are focused on this. So that's why I say maybe just keep D'Angelo away. It just wouldn't hurt just to let him have a bit of time to himself and let the team have a bit of time to himself to decide how they're going to handle it as well. I don't think these things just get forgotten quickly.
I think it will get blown over as soon as he apologizes tonight before the TNT second game of the TNT doubleheader against the Heat. And then we won't talk about it, and that will be a wonderful thing.
Well, yeah, unless he comes out tonight, and again, in the media scrum and says, oh, yeah, I meant to get Swaggy there, and I got I mean, that is unlikely going to happen. So I think, again, it's one of these things. This is a story because the Lakers are brutal, and in the L.A. media, they need something to talk about. This happens. Oh, great. Let's pounce on it. That's why I believe it's a headline. All right, final one here, Trey.
I think you guys are underplaying this. But up next is a headline from NBC Sports, and it reads, Russell Westbrook takes exception with Reggie Jackson's celebrations. Is this news?
This is not news that they don't like each other. This has been going on since Reggie Jackson left, but I'm actually with Russell on this one. I think Reggie does overdo it a little bit. It's fine to enjoy the win, to celebrate a little bit, But I think he does that second one after the free throw. I think it's a little too much.
Oh, my God. He got a win at home against a great team. He's getting the crowd into it. What is he doing wrong here?
Yeah, he's bringing Detroit playoff basketball back. Westbrook was upset about it on the court. You could see that. But I think he might have been upset about it even more after the game.
Honestly, I think some real I don't appreciate it from our team and our organization. I don't like it at all. But, you know, it is what it is. We'll see him down the line. We take care of that when we get there.
I love this. This is Russell Westbrook being Russell Westbrook. I mean, this is why he is who he is. He got fired up because a former guy, a former teammate went at him. And Reggie Jackson wanted his own team. He got what he wanted. He went to Detroit. They obviously butted heads in OKC. Mm-hmm. I don't mind a little gamesmanship.
I don't mind gamesmanship either. But I have to say, he celebrated the first time when he was raising his hands to the fans. And then after that free throw, when the game was over, Russell couldn't do anything about it. He went pretty much right in Russell's face and did it again.
Okay.
I think that's
so
going
you got
to
one celebration per game.
Yeah.
You got a problem with this one.
This is the part here. See how he stops and he's looking right
he's
at Russell.
He's definitely egging on
they,
Russell.
They don't like each other.
I know, but
and
he doesn't
we always
need
sit
to do
here.
That.
We sit here every third day, Lee, and go, oh man, these guys are just all of them are all buddies now, and they hug and they handshake before and after the game.
But he's already done it.
We always complain about that. So that's great that
no,
they actually
celebrated
don't like each
once,
other.
Then you just walk away and leave it there. He's won the game. There's nothing else that needs to be done about it. He did it. He just went one too far on this
Russell
occasion.
Russell Westbrook celebrates and rightfully after
one
every dunk.
But not in someone's face when the game is over and the other guy hasn't got a chance to reply. That's the point I'm trying to make here.
Also with against a team without Kevin Durant.
Probably
wouldn't have been doing that without Kevin
Durant. A win's a win. Crossfire when we return. We're going to celebrate during the commercial.
We're live.
Crossfire! That was literally a fire in here
it
5 seconds
ago. It smells like
ago.
A fire in here. This is how it works. Trey will give Skeets and me 3 topics. We will debate each one, and you at home will declare the winner on Twitter. Trey, let's tell them how it works.
Yeah, if you're following along on Twitter, you think Tass is winning, tweet hashtag Tass wins. If you think Skeets is winning, hashtag Skeets wins. Don't vote for me. I won last week, and it was very awkward for everyone.
That was weird.
Nonetheless, round one.
Woo! Yeah, the shorts!
Round one. LeBron James rested during last night's Cavs loss to the Rockets, kind of, as there were multiple shots of King James coaching on the sidelines both during timeouts and during play. Are you pro or con, Coach LeBron? Here we go!
What's the difference? He coaches this team already.
Oh!
Listen, I'm pro a beautiful basketball mind telling his guys how to play basketball. It can only help the players, especially with LeBron from a different perspective when he doesn't have the uniform on. And I think it could also improve the relationships he has with Kevin Love and Kyrie Irving, relationships which aren't the strongest
sure.
of relationships.
In the huddle where we saw LeBron talking to the guys, yeah, I think that makes a ton of sense. He knows a lot about basketball. He's sharing that
he
knowledge.
Does.
What was weird, you have to admit, Tass, he's literally walking out behind Coach Lou on the sidelines at times, just standing 5 feet behind him, either echoing the same thing Lou's saying
it
or saying something
or
completely
twice.
Else.
Sure.
That part to me was weird.
I think he was just trying to show
strange.
Off his outfit.
Yeah, and, he looked like an assistant coach.
And he was trying to pull a Drake. I mean, you know Drake does that behind Dwayne Casey. Him and LeBron are buds. It's not a big deal. It happened once or twice.
Already had one coach gone from the Cavs this year, and now you got LeBron doing that. I think it shows up the actual coach, in my opinion.
All right. Round two, and everything is coming up, Warriors. As Steph Curry banked in a 3 from the top of the key against the Wizards on the very same night that Draymond Green threw Andrew Bogut a maybe on purpose off the glass alley-oop. You're seeing them here. These guys just going glass for basically no reason, maybe not on purpose. But the question is, which Warrior actually meant to go glass, Curry or Green?
Oh,
here we go.
It's actually a tough question. I'm not sure either of them meant to, but if I have to pick one, I would go Draymond Green. We know he's a great passer. We know he's one of the better big man passers in the game.
But with the left?
He's confident and cocky as get out. So why not? He sees Bogut coming down there. Ah, let's throw it up there. I think, the more I see it, the more possible it really did he mean to do that and go off the glass. I go Draymond.
It could be possible that he did go with the left off the glass on purpose. But Steph Curry cannot be doubted in any way, shape, or form right now. He is changing the game of basketball. And he probably practices this.
No.
He has taken shooting to a whole new level. He banks home threes. He practices it. And you can see his reaction, where he doesn't smile whatsoever. He just reacts as if he hit a regular shot. No. That's Steph Curry's shot. He's taking it to another level.
No three-point shooter ever means to bank home a three. Yeah. Never. Especially someone as good as him. And here's the other thing. Ethan Sherwood-Strauss did ask Draymond Green about going off the glass, and he said, yeah. I meant to. It
we
was
thought
nice.
Steph couldn't shoot from 30 feet. Who says he can't bank
it?
Nice.
All right, all right, all
right. Final round.
And it was.
Get those stems back in here. After Alvin Gentry said, we need a voodoo doctor or something because of the Pelicans' numerous injuries, an actual New Orleans voodoo priest chimed in that he does believe the team is, quote, jinxed, for lack of a better word. Let's open this to the rest of the league. What franchise is cursed? Here we go.
It might be New Orleans, but if I had to pick another team, I think it's the Brooklyn Nets. They've got a beautiful, beautiful building. It's charcoal gray. You've got beautiful food options in there, but they still can't win basketball games. They signed Deron Williams a few years ago. Do you remember that?
Yep.
That did not go so well. Paul Pierce, Kevin Garnett were supposed to be the solution to all their problems. And then this Jason Kidd fiasco. Mikhail Prokhorov said 5 years are going to win a championship. They haven't won anything. And they don't have their draft picks. That's a cursed franchise to me.
Or just a poorly run franchise, whether or not they're cursed.
Deron Williams looked like a very solid player. The ankles, the knees fell apart.
I go with the Oklahoma City Thunder. And not because of what, unfortunately, has happened to them sort of off the court this year with their co-owner in the car crash and, of course, assistant coaches Monty Williams' wife passing. Not because of that. But over the last couple years, we know this is a great basketball team, but they've just missed a star every year. Last year, they missed out on the playoffs because of the Durant injury. The year before that, in the Western Conference Finals, they fall down because of Noah Baca. The year before that, it's Westbrook. They're cursed. And oh, yeah, there's probably a reason why.
They have too many.
Your winner,
James. Oh, wow. They have too many MVP candidates.
No, man.
They have too many
MVP
candidates.
How many titles, Tash?
Four.
We gotta take a break. Wow, that was a heated round of crossfire. Something was actually on fire here, but when we come back, multi-year contract extension for Vlade. We'll debate that more. Welcome back to The Starters. We asked you, what's your go-to three-point distraction move? And a few of you jumped on Twitter, hashtag The Starters, with your answers. Trey, you got some of the best ones.
Oh, some very funny answers, which I have to imagine are super effective. Kels McCall says, my three-point distraction is a little quick game of peekaboo. Hey, hey. Okay. I would like it. Calvin Patterson says, I yell I love you, but if it doesn't work, it's just awkward. Agree. And Nick Colby says, Steve Perry. Shout out to basketball.
Okay. Keep those tweets coming. What's your go-to distraction move? But once again, let's read some emails. Let's open up the Starters mailbox here. Our first question from Matt R. He writes, what are the Kings thinking? Seriously, they're going to miss the playoffs again. DeMarcus and Coach Carl are fighting again. The rest of the team seems like they're in open revolt. And now they've extended Vlade. Why? Best question coming from Matt. What do you think?
Well, Matt, I think they're just trying to instill some stability in this franchise. We know George Carl is going to get fired. Cousins is going to have his sixth coach in seven seasons. So let's keep the GM around. But does Divots have the ability to be a good GM? That is the question. Divots apparently didn't know that you had to make a trade call to the league, that according to Zach Lowe. He also didn't know about the stretch provision, that according to Zach Lowe as well. And when they made that Nick Stauskas deal to Philadelphia before this preseason where they swapped picks, he didn't protect the pick at all. So if the Kings win the draft lottery, which they didn't expect to be in, but could possibly happen, they don't win the draft lottery. Right. The Sixers take that pick. He's made a lot of mistakes. This comes along with the move where they're signing a capologist, a cap guy. But I think they're just trying to instill some stability. He doesn't deserve this extension by what he's done, but I know that they're going to move forward with a new coach, so they're just trying to keep everything a little bit steady, steadying the ship a little bit for DeMarcus Cousins.
Yeah, in the summer is when a GM really has to earn his money, during the draft, during free agency, and just that period between seasons. And I think that then it would have been a better opportunity to evaluate Vlade and see what he did, because you know there's going to be a lot of changes, a lot of playing personnel changes, coaching change definitely, maybe even some shuffling in the front office. So I think it would have been better to sort of let Vlade figure out what he's going to do this summer and then decide if you want to extend him or not, because he would have been working to try to earn a new contract. Now he's kind of got it before he's even really had a chance to do anything.
I mean, Vlade obviously has a great relationship with owner Vivek Ranadive. I mean, there's no doubt this says, to me, the organization feels it's George Karl's fault for the lackluster year and not and not Vlade himself, and they think, well, this guy can just learn on the job. You're absolutely right. I mean, it helps them to have some stability, just whether or not he's the right guy and can learn enough on the job here as a GM. We'll find out. Yeah. All right, next question here. This comes from Dave, all the way in Australia there. He writes, I was playing NBA 2K16 and admiring its commitment to realism when it occurred to me that it lacks one key quality. No wedgies.
No wedgies.
I think the starters needs to start a revolution and compel the good people of NBA 2K to include wedgies in NBA 2K17. That's true. By all accounts, there are no actual wedgies. I know some people have sent in screen grabs from NBA 2K16, but I think they're just sly and are like pausing it at the right time.
We're on to you.
But the good news is, some of you have told us that there are wedgies in some of these games like Fallout 4. That's a post-apocalyptic wedgie. Keon, thank you for pointing that out. A lot of people have actually pointed these out. The Division is also a game. They've got wedgies. They're just stuck there. These aren't basketball games. These are just games with wedgies in them. So we're happy about that. But I do agree with Dave. It'd be nice to add wedgies to NBA 2K17.
It would be great.
I mean, we're already in the game, so why not put wedgies in the game?
I mean, there's really nothing else that isn't in the game, so why not? Yeah, just throw the wedgie in there.
And the best part, though, I gotta check with you, because you are the wedgie master, Tass. Last night, Bubba Watson, pro golfer Bubba Watson, with the half-court shot in Orlando, sticks it!
Whoa.
Now,
wow.
Tass,
wow.
Does this count?
It doesn't count for our total. No.
That's a beautiful wedgie, though.
Sorry, Bubba.
Oh, well, in also the world of wedgies, or sort of wedgies, this middle school basketball game, they lose their title, the one team does, because of a ledgy.
Oh, wow.
That's right. That was the end of the game. Final shot. It sticks there. It's not going anywhere. Game over. That's a tough way to lose.
Ledgy. Ahealy is a great name for that. So we're still at 41.
Oh, man.
Sorry, Bubs.
Sorry, Bubs. If we come up one wedgie short from 50, oh, man, I'm going to be so angry. All right, when we come back, Lili's very solid play.
Is that his real name?
Bubba.
Hey, Bubba.
Back of the starters, look at tonight's pick'em play. Tass, the lone guy here, taking the reps at home. Everybody else taking the Hawks on the road. Good luck to all. Lili, very solid play.
Going out to Golden State, another one from the Warriors. It's the bogeyman with a beautiful pass there to Klay Thompson. Look at Marcin Gortat. He's watching his whop. Got to be quicker than that. That's what I call a very solid play.
That was solid. But now it's time for the highlight. That wasn't. Just because a play isn't converted doesn't mean it wasn't fantastic.
Oh, Swaggy P.
So here we go. Klay Thompson draws three defenders right quick. They all go up to Klay. He drops a beautiful pass to James Michael McAdoo. More one like of the best names in the NBA. What was that?
More like Maca don't.
Got him!
Oh, my God. All right, guys. NBA TV double header tonight. Hawks, Raps, Heat, Lakers. We'll see you tomorrow night.
Thanks for joining us, folks. And remember, check the shake on this.
Whoa. Want some fries with that shake?